Pennsylvania 65,000!
Hello everyone, and welcome to another video on Our Own Devices. I'm Jean Messier, and probably my least favorite type of YouTube video is the type where the older generation tries to stump the younger generation by having them operate some vintage piece of tech. Technology marches on, and expecting somebody to be able to intuitively operate a device that was obsolete before they were even born is decidedly unfair and smacks of the worst type of smugness. So, in the spirit of spreading knowledge rather than mocking ignorance, today we are going to be looking at the history and mechanics of one of the types of tech most commonly used to confuse young people, which is the rotary phone. Now, when the first telephone networks were established in the 1870s and 1880s, they were all based, of course, on manual exchanges. So if you wanted to place a call, what you had to do was lift the receiver, turn a little dynamo crank to signal the operator, and then the operator would use a manual plug board to connect you to the subscriber you wish to reach. And as we'll see a little later on, this system remained in place for a surprisingly long amount of time, indeed for many decades after the invention of automatic telephone switching equipment. Now, up until 1889, there were 27 patents filed in the United States for automatic telephone switching gear. However, the invention and eventual implementation of the first successful automatic switching system is typically attributed to a gentleman named Almon Brown Strowger. And his story has become legendary in the history of telecommunications to the point where it's not quite certain how much of it is actually true and how much of it has been embellished or exaggerated over the years. But I'll tell you the most commonly told version. So Strowger, who lived in Kansas City, Missouri in the 1890s, was a schoolteacher turned mortician. And he was known for being a rather paranoid and cantankerous gentleman. And he became convinced that his competitors, other funeral homes, were bribing the local operator to route calls from potential clients away from his business. And based on this belief, he vowed to find a way to put telephone operators out of work permanently. And so to this end, he put together a prototype of what is now known as a stepper switch or a Strowger switch, which he cobbled together using straight pins and a box meant for holding starched shirt collars. And according to the story, at one point he called the local Bell telephone office to complain about a lack of service, and they sent over a repairman named Herman Ritterhoff. Now, Ritterhoff very quickly found out that the problem with Strowger's telephone had nothing to do with bribery or the operators at all. Rather, it was being caused by a metal sign that he had hung up inside his shop, and whenever anybody opened the door and let the wind in, the sign would short out the terminals on the telephone, causing an interruption of service. But Strowger wasn't hearing anything of it, and he started talking to Ritterhoff about his fantastic new stepper switch invention, and he offered him 10,000 shares in the company that he was going to found. And naturally, Ritterhoff was curious and asked to see the prototype. But as soon as Strowger pulled out this rather crude-looking device, Ritterhoff laughed out loud, at which point Strowger got very angry and kicked him out of his shop. And Ritterhoff would delight in later years in telling the story about how an errant laugh lost him millions of dollars. Now, Strowger was neither an experienced businessman nor an engineer, and so he needed outside help in order to perfect, patent, and market his invention. So in 1891, he teamed up with a group of gentlemen, including Alexander Keith, Charles and John Erickson, and Frank Lundquist, to form the Strowger Automatic Telephone Exchange Company, later the Automatic Electric Company, based out of Chicago. And together, they came up with a refined and functional version of his automatic telephone exchange. And the first commercial automatic exchange was installed in La Porte, Indiana, in February of 1892. Now, this network originally served around 75 subscribers and was advertised using the absolutely fantastic slogan of the girlless, cussless, out-of-orderless, and waitless telephone. Now, by this time, Strowger had already left his own company. He'd sold his shares and his patents for the equivalent of around $300,000 today. Later, in 1916, those same patents would be sold to Bell Telephone for the equivalent of $2.5 million. So you can see just how much money Herman Ritterhoff lost out on with his errant laugh. So we'll have a look at how Strouder's invention, the rotary stepper switch, actually worked in just a minute. But for now, let's discuss how a subscriber to this new automatic telephone exchange would have interacted with that system. So in these early days, phone numbers were only 4 digits, and each telephone would have been equipped with 4 telegraph-style keys, one for each digit. So for example, if your telephone number that you were trying to reach was 4321, you would tap the first key 4 times, then the next one 3 times, next one 2 times, and then the last one once. So while workable, this wasn't a very effective system. It was very easy to dial a wrong number. And so in 1904, Frank Lundquist came up with the rotary dial. And this would become the standard method for dialing a phone number for the next 60 or so years. And this system would remain relatively unchanged throughout that entire period, meaning we can look at how it works by examining a phone from a much later period. This in particular here is a Model 500 style telephone manufactured by Northern Electric, the Canadian subsidiary of Western Electric, around the 1960s. So the first standardized mass-produced dial telephone appeared in 1919, and this was the Western Electric Model 50 AL. And this was a candlestick dial telephone with a dial integrated into the base. Later in 1927, came the Western Electric Model A1, which was the first mass-produced telephone to have the separate base and handset configuration. Then in 1937 came the Model 302, and this was an important milestone in telephone design for several reasons. Number one, it was the first standardized telephone to have the ringer integrated into the base rather than in a separate ringer box. It was also made out of thermoplastic, Bakelite, due to wartime shortages of metal. And third, this telephone was designed by the legendary industrial designer Henry Dreyfuss, who in 1949 would further update the 302 to produce the legendary Model 500 telephone. And Type 500 telephones would be manufactured in vast quantities and used all over the world and would become basically the platonic ideal of a rotary telephone for decades to come. And the next and last development in rotary phone design would come in 1965 with the introduction of the Model 220 Slimline, which used a much smaller dial integrated into the handset. And this would end up being the last mass-produced standard dial phone before the widespread adoption of touch-tone dialing. Right, so let's actually have a closer look at this particular telephone. So rotary dials are actually very easy to use. You simply lift the receiver, and then you place your finger in the hole on the dial corresponding to the number you wish to dial, and then rotate the dial over clockwise until you hit the finger stop. You then release the dial and let it rotate until it stops. Then you go to the next number, rotate it clockwise to the finger stop, release it, and so on and so forth. Now, if we actually remove the cover off the telephone, we can see some of its internal components. So here we have the cradle switch, which disconnects the telephone line, what's known as the local loop, when you hang up the receiver. We have our ringer in the back here, which is just a pair of metal bells rung by a clapper driven by a simple electromagnetic oscillator. And finally, we have our dial, which we can lift up and turn around in order to have a closer look at the mechanism. Now, the dial itself is driven by a helical clock spring, and its speed is regulated by what's known as a governor. And maintaining the dial at a constant speed is very important, because the purpose of the dial is to open and close the telephone circuit, the local loop, very rapidly to produce a series of pulses. This is known as pulse dialing or loop disconnect dialing. And in Frank Lundquist's original design that was patented in 1904, you had to move that dial manually to actually dial each number. And this was unreliable because you could move that dial more slowly or more quickly than was optimal and accidentally create the wrong number of pulses and dial the wrong number. So very soon after that, they integrated the spring and governor mechanism in order to make sure that the dial rotated at the same speed every time. And the governor consists of a set of weights on springs that rotate inside of a metal cup. And if the dial rotates too quickly, centrifugal force pushes those weights outwards against the springs and creates friction that slows the dial down. Now, there's also a spring clutch in this mechanism that disconnects the dial from the actual mechanism while you're winding the dial up, but then connects them together when you release the dial so that you don't accidentally start sending signaling pulses while you're simply winding up the dial. And when you actually wind up the dial and release it, you can see how this mechanism actually works. As the dial spins, this little plastic cam here rapidly opens and closes this switch, creating a series of pulses. So for regular commercial telephones, the pulse rate was typically 10 pulses per second, but for equipment for calling between different telephone exchanges, that was a little bit higher, around 18 to 20 pulses per second. So interestingly enough, there are actually two different variations of the dial mechanism developed at around the same time by two different companies, and both became accepted as standard in the United States. This version was developed by Western Electric and is distinguished by the fact that it uses spur gears so that the axis of the governor and the dial shaft are parallel to one another. The other version was developed by the Automatic Electric Company and is configured a little bit differently. And as luck would have it, I actually have an example of that to show you. So this is an Automatic Electric Company of Canada Model 664, which is a variation of the AEC Model 87 multiple line telephone. And this is a neat telephone in its own right because it has all sorts of interesting little bells and whistles. So this was intended for use in an office and has the provision for three separate telephone lines. And these are represented by three pairs of buttons. One button is to connect to the line. The other one is to place that line on hold. Now, you also have a pair of buttons up here, a silver one and a red one, and these are known as exclusion buttons. And these would be used for creating a telephone bridge. So say you're a secretary and somebody calls in and says they want to be connected to somebody else in the building. Well, in order to do that without risking cutting them off if you hang up your telephone, you can press the silver button and that will connect them to that other user. And then you are free to hang up your phone or switch to another line without interrupting that connection. And if you then want to break that connection, say the call is over, you then press the red button. We also have another silver button here on the front, which is marked signal. And that was to send a ringer signal to all the other telephones on the same system, or more typically would be connected to a secretary's intercom system. And then another interesting detail is that the handset on this is actually made by Northern Electric, even though the phone itself is made by the Automatic Electric Company. And this integrates a push-to-talk switch. And so you would hold this down when you were actually talking and then release it to listen. And this would limit the amount of interference you would get through the handset while you were actually speaking. Right, so let's actually open this up and have a look inside. Right, so you can see that this telephone is a lot more complex than the one that we previously looked at on account of it having to handle many more functions. So for example, the cradle switch has multiple contacts to close off all the different lines. It has extra linkages on it, for example, to reset all of the separate line buttons. Instead of a bell-type ringer at the back, we instead have a little electromagnetic buzzer. And finally, you can see that some of the switching in this telephone is handled not by mechanical switches, but by vacuum tubes. However, what we're interested in here is the dial. So let's actually pop that off. So whereas the Western Electric dial has the dial shaft and the governor shaft parallel to one another and linked by spur gears, the Automatic Electric Company dial has the governor perpendicular to the dial shaft and connected via a worm gear. You'll notice this is a very unusual type of worm gear. Typically in a worm gear train, the worm gear drives the spur gear. And this is because there is zero backlash. You can't drive the spur gear back against the worm gear. In this case, however, the spur gear actually drives the worm gear. And this is accomplished by cutting the worm gear teeth at a very steep angle, 45 degrees, and making them very sharp. So rather unusual system, but hey, it works. And then you'll notice that the governor here is mounted horizontally, and it consists of a pair of weights on springs around a shaft. And as it spins, those weights get pushed outwards and produce friction as they rub against the inside of this collar. But other than that unusual mechanical arrangement, this works exactly the same way as the Western Electric dial. Right, so while we're on the subject of telephone dials, let's have a brief look at the history of telephone numbers. Now, as I stated before, in the early days, telephone numbers tended to have four digits, five if you lived in a big city. But as the number of telephone subscribers continued to grow at an alarming pace, there soon came a need for longer and longer telephone numbers. And when numbers reached seven digits in length, people worried that they wouldn't be able to memorize these and that there would be a huge uptick in misdialed numbers. Thankfully, however, they came up with a rather clever mnemonic trick to solve this problem. So prior to this time, when telephone numbers were only four or five digits long, when you called up the operator, you had to not only give them the number, but also the name of the specific telephone exchange you were trying to contact. So say if I wanted to call somebody in a town called Hamilton, I would probably say Hamilton 4321, Hamilton being the telephone exchange, 4321 being the specific subscriber number. So in the 1910s, what happened in the United States is that the first three digits of the seven-digit telephone number, which corresponded to the exchange, were translated into the first three letters of the name of that exchange. So for example, instead of saying Hamilton 4321, I would instead dial H-A-M 4321, which on this particular dial would correspond to 426, 4321. And this worked very well and became the standard method for communicating phone numbers for quite a few years. However, within about a decade, they started running out of unique three-letter combinations that corresponded to actual place names. And so around the 1930s, the United States switched over to a two-letter, five-number scheme for telephone numbers. And one of the most famous of these is Pennsylvania 65000, which is the phone number for the Pennsylvania Hotel in New York. It's considered to be one of the oldest named exchanges in the United States, and of course the subject of the famous Glenn Miller song. And that corresponded to the first two letters of Pennsylvania, P-E, and then 65000. The PE on a standard American dial corresponding to 73. Another example would be the novel and the famous movie with Elizabeth Taylor, Butterfield 8. That would be BU from Butterfield being the exchange, and then 8 being the number of the subscriber. Now, the manner in which the letters were mapped to the numbers on the telephone dial varied from place to place. So the standard North American dial, which we see here, was introduced in 1917 by an AT&T employee named W.G. Blovere. But say in England, the zero was typically used as an O, whereas in Australia, they only used a handful of letters. A, B, F, J, L, M, U, W, X, Y. And Australians remembered this mapping through the amusing mnemonic of all big fish jump like mad underwater, except yabbies, yabbies being crayfish. As for the Eastern Bloc, the Soviet Union and all its satellite states, they briefly experimented with mapping Cyrillic letters onto their numerical dials, but quickly abandoned this and used all numerical dialing for the rest of the 20th century. Whereas in the United States, all numeric dialing didn't become the standard until around the 1960s. So in addition to the mapping of letters onto numbers, the actual arrangement of numbers on telephone dials varied from place to place. So for example, in North America and Britain, the standard arrangement was 1 to 9 and then 0, whereas in the rest of Europe, it was 0, then 1 to 9. And these differences had a huge impact on a number of different things, including the development of emergency phone numbers. So prior to the development of dedicated emergency phone numbers, it was often very difficult to get a hold of emergency services. You would have to dial the operator who might be busy and would take a long time to connect you to the proper authorities. Or you would have to call the police station or the fire hall, the number for which could be different from place to place. So in 1937, the UK introduced the world's first dedicated emergency number, which was 999. Now, this was chosen for an interesting mechanical reason. So as I said, British dials went from 1 to 9 and then 0. And 0 was already set up in the exchange system to be free because that's how you dialed the operator. And so it wasn't difficult to modify the pulse dialing cam to also make 9 free so that you could dial 999 from a payphone without having to pay. But while certainly more efficient than previous systems, 999 still had a number of drawbacks. For one thing, it took a long time to dial. After all, the 9 is the second highest number on the dial, and it takes a long time to go around when you try to dial it. Secondly, it was difficult for people to find the 9 on the dial in the dark or in a smoke-filled room or other emergency situations, leading to a lot of misdialing. So this leads to the question, why, other than, you know, mechanical convenience, would you not go for a shorter and easier to find number such as 111? Well, unfortunately, that doesn't work either because 111 is far too easy to dial accidentally. Indeed, you can accidentally dial 111 on a rotary phone by simply pushing the cradle switch 3 times in quick succession. Because both the cradle switch and the dial work by interrupting the local loop circuit, creating electrical pulses, the telephone switching gear doesn't know the difference between a signal sent by the dial or by the cradle. And so while 999 certainly had its drawbacks, by using a large number of pulses, it significantly reduced the risk of being accidentally dialed. Now, in New Zealand, they actually did use 111 as an emergency phone number. That's because New Zealand phone dials were reverse wired, meaning that dialing 1 generated a train of 9 pulses. And this meant that they could use British switching equipment off the shelf without any modifications. Now, in Europe, they chose a compromise, which was 112. So this had the advantage of being easy to remember and quick to dial, but by adding that one extra pulse made it less likely to be accidentally dialed, and that's the number they use to this day. Now, many places in North America briefly considered adopting the British 999 system, though due to various technical quirks in the North American telephone switching network, this number proved largely incompatible. So instead, they decided to go for 911. There are a number of reasons for this. Number one, it's easy to remember. Number two, it's easy to dial. Indeed, it strikes the perfect balance between being short enough to dial quickly, whereas being long enough in terms of number of pulses, so that the risk of dialing it accidentally is very low. Also, at the time, 911 was not assigned to any telephone exchange or other address in the United States. It was completely available and wouldn't interfere with any other part of the system. And finally, the middle one worked very well with the established system because that was used to indicate a non-standard call, a special communication. And that's why we still use it to this day. And fun fact, the first city in North America to officially adopt 911 was my hometown of Winnipeg in 1959, the United States following suit starting in 1968. Now, before we move on, just a quick note on something that I briefly mentioned earlier in the video, which is the fact that with a rotary dial system, you can accidentally dial a number by tapping on the cradle switch. Indeed, this fact was for many years used by people to bypass payphones and make free calls. You see, as I said before, both the rotary dial and the cradle switch work by interrupting the local loop circuit. And so if you can tap the switch fast enough to imitate the pulses coming from the dial, the telephone switching equipment at the exchange doesn't know the difference. And so you can fool it into thinking that you actually dialed the number, even if the dial is locked out, as in a payphone. And in the UK, this came with the charge, if you were caught, of abstracting electricity, which meant to misuse or divert electricity from its rightful owner. In this case, the British Post Office, which operated all of the country's telephones. And this was an early predecessor of phreaking, which is the practice of hacking a dual-tone multi-frequency or touch-tone telephone exchange system. And this was the system that superseded the rotary dial system, which used different combinations of tones in order to represent different numbers and activate different telephone switches. And phreakers, as they called themselves, would use a variety of methods to replicate these tones in order to bypass payphones or tolls or other obstacles and obtain, for example, free long-distance calls. So they would do things like build blue boxes, which were little electronic packages that could generate various tones Or, in one amusing example, they found that the toy whistle that came in certain boxes of Captain Crunch actually produced the correct frequency to tell the telephone exchange to accept a long-distance call. And building blue boxes for Freakers was one of the early activities of Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, the founders of Apple. Right, so now let's talk about how rotary dials actually controlled the switching equipment in telephone exchanges. Now, at some point, I would love to get my hands on an actual Strowger switch. They're just marvels of electromechanical engineering. But at its most basic, a Strowger switch consists of a semi-cylindrical array of electrical contacts, typically 100 of them arranged in 10 rows and 10 columns. And these can be connected to using an electrical contact called a wiper, which can move in two different directions. It can slide up and down, and it can pivot side to side, allowing it to connect to any one of those 100 contacts. And the movement of the wiper was driven by a set of stepper motors, which are controlled by the electrical pulses generated by the telephone dial. And Strowger switches form the core of what was known as the step-by-step switching system. And this consisted of several cascades of Strowger switches connected in series and arranged in one of three different configurations, either a line finder, a selector, or a connector. So how this worked is when you remove the receiver from the cradle, this would close the local loop circuit and signal to the telephone exchange that your subscriber line required service. And so the line finder would automatically connect your subscriber line to the rest of the system and provide you with a dial tone, which would signal that the system was ready to accept the phone number. Then you would dial the first number in the sequence. And this would cause the wiper on the first selector to move up by that number of pulses. So say if you dialed a 5, it would move up 5 spaces. It would then automatically hunt, it would swivel horizontally to find an open trunk line and connect to it, which would connect you to the next selector. You would then enter the second number and the same thing would happen. The second selector would move up by that number of pulses and then automatically hunt for an available line. This would continue until you got to the last two digits of the phone number, which would be handled by the third type of Strowger switch, the connector. So when you dialed the penultimate number, the connector's wiper would move up by that number of pulses, but it wouldn't automatically hunt for an open line. Because at this point, what the system is doing is selecting from one of 100 subscriber lines within that particular Strowger switch to connect you to the intended recipient. And so that switch is going to wait until you dial the last number, at which point the wiper is going to swivel by that number of pulses to finally connect you with the recipient. And then one of two things is going to happen. Either the line is available, it's going to activate the recipient's ringer, or the line is busy and it's going to return a busy signal. And then when you hang up and disconnect the local loop, all the Strowger switches are going to automatically disconnect and reset, ready to handle the next phone call. And this is the way that telephone exchanges worked for quite a few decades. But there was a major drawback to this system, and that was the problem of scalability. So what you have to realize is that at each level of the exchange, each Strowger switch has to be connected to another 100 Strowger switches, one for each electrical contact in the first switch. So after a certain number of levels, this really gets hardware intensive and unwieldy. And it also means that a whole bunch of hardware has to be dedicated to handling each individual call, making the whole system very inefficient. And so in the 1910s, you started seeing the adoption of another type of system called the panel switching system. And a panel switch was a huge device. Some of them were up to 6 meters tall, with a whole array of electrical contacts and a sliding electrical contact called a brush that could be driven by high-speed electric motors and could move up and across the frame to connect to each of those contacts. And due to the number of contacts that could be contained within a certain space, this was a lot more space efficient than the older Strowger switch system. But far more important than the physical hardware itself was the way in which it was organized and connected. So in 1905, an AT&T employee named Edward Molina conducted a statistical analysis of the whole telephone system. What he realized was that if you could disconnect the actual physical phone numbers from the control of the telephone switches, you could make far more efficient use of the entire network. And so the panel switching systems used a very complex electromechanical circuit known as the sender. And while you dial the number just as before, rather than directly controlling the Strouger switches as in the older system, instead that number was absorbed by the sender and translated into an arbitrary internal code, which was then used to signal all the panel switches and connect the call. And then once the sender circuit had set up a certain call, it would then disconnect and move on to setting up the next call. This meant that you didn't have a whole bunch of equipment tied up on a single call. The sender would only be occupied on that call for about the 10 seconds that it took to set it up. This meant that a lot more of the equipment in a telephone exchange could be common and used wherever it was needed. And so this made the whole system a lot more efficient. Now, in the late 1930s, you started seeing a third type of switching system called the crossbar switch. And this was effectively an automatic version of the manual plug boards used by human telephone operators. So in those old plug boards, you had a horizontal and vertical array of metal strips with holes drilled at each of the intersections. And so when you actually put in your telephone jack, it would connect those two strips and connect to that particular line. So automatic crossbar switches worked in pretty much the same manner, only they used mechanical servos to close each of those junctions. And because the components on a crossbar switch didn't have to move all that far in order to make a connection, compared to the panel switches with their sliding brushes moving all the way across the panel, these were a lot more reliable and less maintenance intensive than the panel switches. And just like the old panel switching systems, the crossbar switching systems had a sophisticated electromechanical computer called a marker, which would figure out the most effective way to route any particular call. And when I say sophisticated, I do mean sophisticated. Indeed, the marker system from the crossbar switch number 5 system holds the record for the most complex electromechanical computer ever devised, with some 1,500 electromechanical relays in it. However, by the 1970s and 80s, most countries have started moving away from rotary dial and analog switching systems in favor of dual-tone multi-frequency, DMTF, or touch-tone dialing, and digital switching systems. Now, touch-tone dialing is a little beyond the scope of this video, but very briefly, this was first introduced to the public at the 1962 Seattle World's Fair, and this system uses a combination of different frequency tones in order to represent different numbers and signal the telephone switches. So the standard DMTF keypad consists of a 4x4 array of high and low frequencies, the high frequencies being 1209, 1336, 1477, and 1633 hertz, and the low frequencies being 697, 770, 852, and 941 hertz. And so the number 1, for example, would be represented by the combination of 1209 and 697 hertz. And it is these frequencies that the freakers I was talking about before tried to replicate in order to hack the telephone switching system and place free calls. But like I said, touch-tone dialing is a subject for another video. Now, given that automatic switching systems were developed so soon after the invention of the telephone, you would think that the major players like Bell would have immediately adopted that technology as a cost-saving measure. But this, surprisingly, isn't the case. In fact, Bell held on to the old-fashioned human operator system for many decades after the establishment of automatic switching systems. And there are two main reasons for this. The first was customer experience. See, Bell didn't think that automatic switching gave any value to the customer. On the contrary, they thought it was just a way of offloading labor from a trained and paid operator onto the customer themselves, basically like self-checkout kiosks in stores today. And they believed that a trained operator would always provide superior service. The other reason had to do with the scalability problem that we discussed earlier. With the step-by-step switching system, after you reach a certain number of subscribers, the sheer amount of machinery that you need to route these calls quickly becomes uneconomical. It's for this reason that automatic switching systems were actually first adopted not by the major players like Bell, but rather by the dozens of independent telephone companies that emerged after the 1894 expiration of Alexander Graham Bell's original telephone patent. And these independent companies did very well for themselves at first. Indeed, by 1907, they had nearly 50% of the US market share, the other 50% belonging to Bell. And they did this by focusing on rural areas where automatic switching systems actually had a distinct advantage. In rural areas, you don't have that great a number of subscribers, so you don't run into the scaling problem, and it allows these independent operators to reduce the amount of overhead in their operations, since they don't need to train and pay large numbers of telephone operators. And so this is where automatic switching systems first found their niche. And indeed, it wasn't until 1922, almost 30 years after the development of automatic switching, that Bell Telephone installed its first automatic exchange in a major city. And their hand was really forced in this case by the rising costs of labor following the First World War. And eventually, Bell would succeed in squeezing out all of its independent competitors by exploiting its one major advantage, which was its near monopoly on long-distance calling. And this sequence of adoption is actually the complete opposite of what you would expect and is highly unusual in the history of business, because it's typically the larger operators who have a lot more money and other resources to invest who are the early adopters of advanced labor-saving technology. But in this particular case, because of Bell's particular business philosophy and the technical quirks of early telephone switching technology, it was instead the smaller operators who were the early adopters. Anyway, that is a very brief surface-level overview of rotary dials and analog switching systems. There is a lot more to this subject that I couldn't hope to cover in this video, but if you want to learn more about the nitty-gritty of telephone switching systems, I've linked to two channels in the description that go into a lot more detail than I did, so hopefully you'll check those out. Anyway, that's all I have for you today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time on another video where we'll look at yet more fascinating devices just like this. Until then, I'm Jean Messier from Our Own Devices. Have a great day.